Are nerve blocks dangerous? In short, yes. To accomplish a block, the operator has to place a needle in the vicinity of the nerve and inject local anesthetic. Let's simplify this. Needle is a sharp object, whereas a nerve is a vulnerable structure. You can think about it, a nerve is like a telephone cable with hundreds of small little wires inside. If the needle makes its way into the cable, it is like a knife and it's likely to cut some wires. While the cable may still be functional, because not all wires are cut, there may be functions that cannot be replaced because the specific transmission of the small wires that are cut will be gone. In the nerve block analogy, this would mean that some connecting neurons will become dysfunctional for some period of time or permanently. As a reminder, the nerves do not heal well. Their regenerative capacity is much smaller than that of any other tissues. As an example, if you cut the skin or muscle or tendon, the structures can be pieced together by stitching them up and creating scar tissue that works as a gel, so that the skin, muscle, or tendon continues to perform similarly to what it was before the injury. However, the formation of the scar tissue inside the nerve is always bad and leads to potentially disastrous consequences. Anybody who has seen or treated a patient with a nerve injury can attest how traumatic and disabling nerve injuries are. Fortunately, nerve injury caused by a nerve block is not very common. What is really inconceivable is that although nerve blocks are a common practice, there are virtually no established standards on how to perform them safely. And in the absence of the safety standards and monitoring during peripheral nerve blocks, clinicians are left to experiment based on their own experience or recommendations received in different workshops, pro and con sessions, videos of blocks published in social media, and recommendations in the literature describing various new techniques. As an example, in the last video on YouTube, I talked about how dangerous these various techniques are to reproduce by watching them on YouTube or social media. When enthusiastic practitioners of regional anesthesia publish them in order to demonstrate their skill. In one video example, the enthusiastic practitioner performed as many as 8 injections to accomplish interscalene brachial plexus block for something that a single injection is more than adequate. In essence, this practitioner was playing a Russian roulette in the absence of guidance by established standards, while thinking that he was doing a good thing. It is just fortunate that needles are much more likely to avoid than to transect fascicles. But just like in Russian roulette, you're 5 times more likely to survive a click than to get killed by a bullet. However, the more clicks you make, the higher the chance that the gun will fire. When thinking about peripheral nerve blocks, this animation is crucial in understanding what we should and should not do. In this NYSORA reverse ultrasound anatomy animation, we can see an example of perineural injection with the local anesthetic spreading around the nerve. Such an injection results in a timely onset of block and it's very safe. However, if the needle is accidentally or intentionally advanced intraneurally, it can cut the intraneural blood vessels, resulting in hematoma and ischemia of the nerve with resultant inflammation and neurological symptoms. The needle may also enter the fascicle, cutting the wires that we talked about in our analogy with the telephone cable. Consequent injection into the fascicles with the needle placed intranarally can further disrupt the fascicles and cause mechanical, hydraulic, and local anesthetic toxicity damage. Absence of established standards on how to safely perform peripheral nerve blocks makes the nerve block practice potentially dangerous and leads to recommendations of unsafe practice. As an example, the authors of this chapter in one of the textbooks of regional anesthesia actually promotes intraneural injection. I doubt that the author would consent on having an intraneural injection done on himself. However, if you are a patient, you should not worry about nerve injury with nerve blocks, because the complications of nerve blocks are very uncommon. And nerve blocks are done by skilled practitioners who utilize objective monitoring to avoid complications. But if you are a student trying to learn peripheral nerve blocks, it can be quite challenging because of the absence of the standards and the vast differences in recommendations and opinions on what constitutes successful and safe practice. And this is one of the main priorities of NYSORA as an organization, to teach peripheral nerve blocks and regional anesthesia using decades-proven internal standards that have been successfully introduced in numerous clinical practices worldwide and have stood the test of time. I strongly suggest you to download our nerve block application. The consistency of the message and techniques and the simplicity with which we approach each and every nerve block at NYSORA will likely change your practice. Thank you for watching, and if you like our content, feel free to subscribe and never miss the future videos. Greetings.